locker rooms, public squares, recovery groups, sanctuaries. We often hear this call, rise up. It means it's time for us to be about the work that we're called to do. It's a call to get back to business and work as a team to do some good things. And that's the message of this piece of scripture, Ezekiel 37, bringing together all the bones that are scattered over a valley, putting the bones together with sinning, bringing the people of Israel back to life because they feel like they've lost hope and that they're dead because Babylon was a pretty brutal nation. And they came through and completely destroyed their capital city of Jerusalem. And they hauled away all the people who were intellectuals, all the people from the government, all the people who had skills that might be valuable as slaves, and led them away to Babylon. And in that vision, Ezekiel had in the middle of the night is a spiritual vision. It's not a literal vision. It's not as if you could take a map of the ancient Middle East and all of a sudden on a geographic map point out where the Valley of Dry Bones is. Because this is a spiritual reading. But I can guarantee you that you will find a valley of dry bones somewhere along in the timeline of your life. And there was a time that you were stopped from doing something that you really wanted to do. There was a time when your health failed you. There was a time on Desolation Road. There was a time of hopelessness. There was a time when you had no control over your future. Now, we like to be in control. People of Israel like to be in control, but this passage says that that's God's job. The future is God's and not ours. So this passage gives us some really good spiritual themes. The theme of being in exile and the theme of what it takes for us to return to life that's meaningful. So in your spiritual discernment today about this passage, I want you to consider, first of all, that this is a spiritual image. Sometimes those spiritual images come to us in dreams. Sometimes they disappear. Sometimes the prophets draw a picture of the situation and tell a story about it. But consider today, where are the dry bones in your life? Where are there people who've lost hope? What words do you have to speak to broken people that can bring them back to life and bring them back to community and learn how to trust again? Some of you may know the timeline of the Beatles. Anybody know the timeline of the Beatles? I bet some of you got all the albums, right? You got the White Album, and Abbey Road. You got all those albums, right? How many of you have those albums? Oh, come on, there's more Beatles, but people don't want to admit they're Beatles fans. When did they break up? What year? There's no Beatles people here today? Okay, 1970. 1968, they started having problems. You guys know, you don't want to say anything. 1968, the Beatles are having problems. Having problems with one another, they're having problems with addiction. Paul McCartney especially, he was having problems with addiction. Almost died. And he was wondering how he could continue to be creative, because there was a lot of pressure on this guy to produce. You know, produce albums are very popular. You don't want to lose that popularity. And how can you continue to produce good stuff so people continue to listen? So one night, when he was at home, he laid down in the middle of the night. He was completely out because of his use of alcohol. And had a dream. He had a dream that his mother came to him. Now, his mother died when he was 14 years old. 14 years old. She was a nurse. She worked really hard to make sure that the family had what they needed. And he said one thing about her was that he really could never remember her face when he was trying to. kindness in her faith as she came to him and she said, "Let it be." So, some of you may have heard the lyrics. I know none of you are Beatles fans, but some of you may have heard the lyrics. "When I find myself in times of trouble, Mother Mary comes to me, speaking words of wisdom. Let it be." You guys got it now. Paul McCartney said, "She was there to visit me." Those words are very special to me, because not only did my mom come to me in a dream and reassure me during a very difficult time in my life, things did get better after that, but also it was healing because I put them into a song and I recorded it with Beatles, and it became a healing statement for many other people too. We have to speak about rising up. We have to speak about gathering the dry bones in the desert. We have to speak about recovery. We have to speak about hope. We have to speak about grabbing a hold of a vision of a better world. And that's the way all these simple messages from beyond take place. You probably had some dream like that, some larger than life spiritual reality that came to you. And they usually say things like, "I'm your friend. It's okay. Let it be." And in Ezekiel's time, he said, "Rise up." Sometimes you just have to say the word in order for it to be real. Now I want you to really appreciate scripture, I guess. And you kind of wonder what the original people who read this prophecy of Ezekiel were thinking. Because it's an ancient horror story, right? It's as graphic as Edgar Allan Poe or Stephen King. Can you imagine this stuff in the Bible? But it's about beginning new life. It's about deciding what God wants for you and the choices that you need to make to grab hold of it. So you have to speak it. You have to say it. And this is one of those images that we often talk about, to talk about our connection to God and the way that God holds us out and helps us to see things. So what is this story telling us in our gut? It's telling us, don't give up on life. Don't give up when you have hopeless moments. Because before you know it, it's going to come together and you're going to rise up. And faith is really an awareness of spiritual things. You'll notice that phrase that keeps being repeated over and over again. That God is the one that has the power to do these things. Say the words. Really, that's what we encourage you to do in worship, right? We write the words in a bulletin, and we have you say them. And we hope that they stick. We hope that you take them with them. Take you with them. This last Monday, we had Ms. Zimmer's memorial service. And I was sitting in the funeral home. And they played a song that she had selected for her memorial service. She said the song that she wanted to be played. Now you could think about that for a minute, and I could take a quiz, and you might come up with a whole lot of different things, but the hymn that she chose was, "I Was There to Hear Your Morning Cry." You know that song that we sing here? When the evening gently closes in and you shut your weary eyes, I'll be there as I've always been with just one more surprise. Remember that song? Ms. Zimmer picked that at the beginning of her memorial service. So we make you say the words because they stick, because you have hope in them, and because it's a vision of a better future. Do you remember when someone said those words to you? Do you remember when your mother made you say that you were sorry to someone else? It made a difference if you said those words or not, right? There's something magical about saying the words. And our scripture takes on a life of its own. And Ezekiel wanted you to know God's power. Wanted you to know that that's the only question that's important. Does God have the power to do this? Now today's our communion service, so I want to say that there are earthly meanings in communion, and there are spiritual meanings in communion. The earthly meanings in communion are that we're making a covenant together to be about the work that we know Jesus would have us do in this age and in this time we're living in. And as we look around in the community, we have to look for the valleys of dry bones. And for me, it's not hard to see those places. And I know it must not be hard for you either. But this communion calls us to the earthly business of creating a resurrection in the community, to creating a resurrectional hope in people. And so we look for those people who are facing a valley of dry bones. It also has a spiritual meaning. It has a spiritual meaning for us because we're only 2 weeks away from Easter Sunday. And in communion, if you want to imagine that this morning, it's a mass, right? There's a reason why the Roman Catholic Church uses that word. Because the body of Christ comes together. And so today in this communion service, we've all come from our own places. We all are a bone here and a bone there, but when we come together, we are something different. We are the body of Christ. And in this meal, we become one in that service and in that resurrection. So I'm going to say the same thing to you that they say in locker rooms, that they say on public squares, or sometimes we say in the sanctuary, put your life together. Rise up, piece by piece, and bring those pieces together. Because that valley of dry bones that you're looking at will rise up if you say the word. Amen.